As you know, the title of today's event is, "But Can We Afford It?" And that's pretty much the only question that you can be certain will be asked of any policy proposal. And so what we're here to do today is to sort of unpack that. I think, you know, when we scheduled this, we thought that we'd be talking about, you know, the full title, priorities for the next administration. We were expecting a different administration, but obviously it's still highly relevant. We have two awesome speakers, Professor Stephanie Kelton from the University of Missouri, Kansas City. She was featured in the Politico 50, former chief economist for the Senate Budget Committee, Democratic staff, and economic advisor to Bernie Sanders' campaign. We also have Amar Arganti from GMO. He was formerly the deputy director of the Office of Debt Management at the Treasury. So with that, I'll hand it over.
Okay, thank you. Is the microphone working? Good, okay. Well, I drew the short straw, so I get to go first, which is good news because it means I get all the time that I need, right? So thank you very much to Rowan and to Dan and to everyone behind the scenes who put this together. The events like this are not easy to organize, so we do appreciate everything that you did to get us here to talk with you today. So, as Dan said, we thought that, I think when this panel was originally conceived, we thought that we were going to be addressing questions for the next administration, where the next administration, most of us anticipated it to look a little bit different than it turned out to look. But as you said, the questions are still very, very relevant because they're policy-related questions, and one way or the other, we're going to get economic policy going forward. And so we have to talk about what that might look like and what the real options available to the U.S. are. And so my area of expertise is mostly, I would say, in macroeconomics. I do international finance and so forth, but I pay a lot of attention to fiscal policy. And you're going to talk a lot about your time at the Treasury, but I think also a lot of insights from how the Fed and Treasury coordinate and work together. So we're going to have this sort of fiscal monetary nexus, how do the pieces fit together, how does policy actually work sort of conversation. I'm going to bring the F word up a lot. It's a word that people were pretty reluctant to talk about over the last 8 years, and here I'm talking obviously about fiscal policy. After the Great Recession, you all know that budget deficits exploded and quickly became something that Washington, D.C., everything from Congress to the White House, people became very obsessed with finding ways to reduce budget deficits. And nobody really wanted to talk a lot about fiscal policy. Yes, we got the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, or the so-called Stimulus Act, and that was fiscal policy to be sure. But that was sort of a desperate measure cobbled together quickly in the wake of the financial crisis to try to figure out something by way of putting a floor under the economy so that things didn't completely, the bottom didn't completely fall out and we end up in a full-blown depression. But after that, we didn't talk much about fiscal policy. Attention really turned to what can we do to reduce the size of budget deficits. And then we got ourselves kind of preoccupied with austerity and ways to reduce budget deficits. So now it appears that we are entering a new phase, a new era, one in which the F word is going to come back into vogue. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about what that might mean. Here's a short video. It runs just under 2 minutes, but it's going to set the sort of stage for my remarks. And so I'm going to play it for you. Enjoy your sushi, and here we go.
Taking money from our children and borrowing from China.
Take out a credit card from the Bank of China in the name of our children, driving up our national debt that we have to pay back. That's irresponsible. It's unpatriotic.
The government's irresponsible spending is turning us into slaves. You might well literally lock us into chains, at least our children.
We've got to deal with this big long-term debt problem, or it will deal with us.
And it is a, I think it's a, I think it is, it's a...
Join us to stop this fiscal train wreck. Join us to protect our children
from an inferior standard of living, from a crushing burden of debt and taxes.
Okay, I don't believe in any of the tax cuts. I didn't know what tax cuts were. I didn't even want to own the middle class. And you know why? Because it puts a $400 billion hole in the budget and we just can't afford it.
And as we discuss deficit reduction, which is clearly a major issue.
For decades, we have piled deficit upon deficit, mortgaging our future and our children's future.
And the deficit thing is real, and the debt thing is real. We are really in trouble, and at some point.
Is there a need for comprehensive deficit reduction? The answer is not only yes, but hell yes.
It's debt that hangs over our head, a government that spends more money than it takes in. That's not sustainable.
You cannot cut taxes or increase spending unless you can pay for it.
The math of federal spending does not add up.
And we are spending money we do not have.
A debt burden. That's crushing us.
To me, this is more of a moral issue. You can't steal from your kids and grandkids.
Deficit. We think the deficit and the national debt are at a moral level.
National debt is America's biggest problem.
Okay, allow me to quote the president-elect. Wrong. Wrong. But this is a basic view, right? You didn't know you were going to get stand-up comedy. Right? Sushi and stand-up comedy. This is the pervasive view. I mean, people say all the time, oh, nobody in Washington agrees on anything. Baloney. They all agree on this. Okay? This is absolutely commonly held. Now, with how much conviction, how much of it is political theater, those are a different question. But at least rhetorically, everybody's on the same page on this issue, right? And because we've had this mentality that fiscal policy is not an option, and the reason it's not an option is because we already face a grave national security threat, an immoral impending crisis looming out there and so forth, we can't use the fiscal arm of our policy lever, leaving us with what? The monetary policy arm of the lever. And those of you who have taken any course in economics ever know that when you look at macroeconomics, it's always about fiscal and monetary policy, right? Those two options. Well, if one of them is considered off the table, then you're left with the only other one. And for us, for a very long period of time, that was the Federal Reserve. So the Fed did what the Fed could do, beginning initially with conventional stuff, like cutting interest rates, standard thing to do. But then you can only go so far, or at least so we thought, by cutting interest rates to zero, and then you have to start to get creative. And if Congress isn't doing anything on the fiscal side, you might get very creative. And so we got things that quantitative easing. Okay, I'm not gonna have time to talk a lot about what that was and so forth, but the Fed did some unconventional things, buying mortgage-backed securities, buying billions of dollars of US treasuries, all hoping that somehow this was going to push interest rates down, encourage people to take on more debt, borrow and fuel a consumption investment binge that would stimulate economic activity, boost demand and create jobs and so forth. And then using reliance on forward guidance, talking, communicating with markets, making it sure that the Fed was being well understood, that its intentions were well understood so that markets could take positions, right, that investors could take positions based on the knowledge that the Fed was going to do certain things, was committed to a certain kind of easy policy going forward. All of these things, design, zero interest rate policy, QE, forward guidance, and so forth, to exhaust the Fed's toolkit. Like, just, you know, use everything you've got, pull out all those stops, and try to boost economic activity so that we keep the recovery going and we don't slip back into recession. Now, we had people at the Fed, and here's Ben Bernanke testifying as chairman of the Fed, trying to ask for help, but not wanting to really use the F word. And so how did he go about conveying to Congress that, you know, he could use a little help? And this is what he said.
Essentially in a negative real interest rate environment already.
Let me just agree with you on the following, that monetary policy is not a panacea. It is not the ideal tool.
Okay, monetary policy is not a panacea. It's not even the ideal tool. Now, if the chairman of the Federal Reserve sits down in the midst of an economic crisis and tells you, don't look at us, right? We set interest rates, we do monetary policy. This is not the ideal tool. This is not a panacea, it's not even the ideal tool. What do you suppose he's trying to say? He's trying to say, reach for the other lever. right? It's fiscal policy. You guys have to get in the game. And don't leave it all up to us. This was his way of, as Federal Reserve chairs do, very delicately trying to ask for fiscal assistance that was clearly desperately needed at the time. There are people who since then have been more willing to use the F word, like, for example, John Williams, president of San Francisco Fed. Williams has come out, and this is just this year, okay, so it's not like this was back when we were in the middle of a crisis and people are no longer saying these things. This is President of San Francisco Fed saying, we could come up, if we could come up with better fiscal policy, it would take some of the pressure off of us at the Fed to try to cope with other ways, to come up with other ways to deal with crises as opposed to increasing the Fed's balance sheet, doing QE, and all this other sort of stuff that central banks around the world are reaching to, these unconventional things. So he uses the word fiscal. If we could come up with better fiscal policy. So again, we're entering that phase where it's becoming okay to utter this word again. And why is that? It's because a lot of people are starting to think about what happens when the next recession comes. And it will come, right? We're never going to really reach a point in any capitalist economy anywhere on earth where we are recession-proof, where output doesn't cycle over time. We have business cycles, and we always, presumably always will. Okay, we're in the recovery phase of one now, but eventually the economy will go into a contraction phase. We'll have a recession. The good news is it will be followed by another recovery, because that's how the economy works. The bad news from the perspective of the Fed is that they're essentially out of ammunition if the next recession comes sooner rather than later. Why? Because interest rates are still very close to zero today. And so the tool the Fed has used in the past to address weakness in the overall economy is interest rate cuts. So go back to the 1950s. Start at the little dot on the top. What did the Federal Reserve do during that recession? It cut interest rates by how much? That much. 150 basis points or whatever, percent and a half, whatever that is, 2%. And then when the economy recovered, they raised rates back up to a level that was higher than its previous high. And that gave space so that when the economy turned down, they could cut rates again. And in the recovery, they raised rates way back up high, higher than they had been in the previous, and then they had a lot of space to cut. But look what's happened over time. They've cut, but never hiked back up above previous highs. And so leaving less and less space to use interest rates as a tool to respond to economic weakness. And so the concern here is that since we're out of conventional ammunition, if the next recession comes soon, we'll have to go back and do the unconventional stuff. And this is what Janet Yellen talked about recently at the conference in Jackson Hole. Well, if it comes sooner rather than later, we'll just do what we did last time. We'll do more QE and we'll use forward guidance. It worked last time, after all, is what she's arguing. So presumably, we can rely on the same sorts of things. Again, you guys are laughing. I don't even know what the comic is. Oh, yeah. So, but in central banks outside of the U.S., they've discovered that zero actually isn't as low as you can go. You can go lower than zero. I forgot about negative interest rates, like negative numbers. So you've got central banks now setting interest rates in negative territory. And you've got a third of the global government bond market trading in negative territory. So that government securities are no longer fixed income assets, but they become fixed loss assets. It's sort of a crazy world that we're in at this point. Now, the Fed has said they're not interested in not looking at negative interest rates, but maybe they'll do other things, like some of this NGDP targeting, targeting nominal GDP, which is really saying targeting inflation. That what we want to do is, you know, try something we haven't tried before and openly announce that we're going to go for higher inflation targets. And somehow that's going to be the key to handling and dealing with the next recession. I hope not. I hope we've learned an important lesson and that we're learning from the experience in Japan and elsewhere with both negative interest rates and inflation targeting. Again, I don't have time to tell you what the problems have been. But I hope that we're going to wise up and start rethinking the need for fiscal and not go through another period where we're relying on central banks to do everything. So we've got this newly elected president. What has he said? This is back when he was campaigning. And he was pretty honest, I think, at this point in saying, look, whether it's Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump who becomes president, you're going to see the deficit and you're going to see debt, the national debt go up. Okay? Because he says, you got to do these things. You have to invest in your economies, or in his words, you will die on the vine. You have to make certain investments. He says it's called priming the pump, and you just have to do it. Now he's talking about fiscal policy here, okay? So what sorts of things has he been talking about so far? He's talking about tax reform, by which he means across the board tax cuts, both corporate taxes, personal income taxes, estate taxes, a variety of things, geared mainly skewed significantly in favor of those who are already at the top of the income and wealth ladder, right? So that the poorest 20% of Americans would see less than 1% cut in taxes benefit, whereas those at the very top are looking at 14% or more, right? So they're skewed, but he's talking about cutting taxes for everyone. He's talking about increased spending on infrastructure. $1 trillion over 10 years is what he's put forward so far, and boosting up the military. So it looks Reagan-esque in many ways, right? Expansionary fiscal policy with massive tax relief on one hand and increased military and domestic spending here on infrastructure on the other. What have people said who've looked at the Trump proposal? Well, a lot of people go right to the debt and the deficit. What's the impact on the debt? What's going to happen to the deficit as a result of the Trump? As if that's the key question. As if that's the key question. Why do they go there? Because you saw the video clip, and that is the obsession in Washington, D.C. How are you going to pay for it, right? What's going to happen to the debt? We already have a crisis. It's a burden. Future grandchildren will be better off with roads they can't drive on and bridges that collapse on them than inheriting more treasury bonds, okay, is presumably the concern here. So people who've looked at this said, why Donald Trump's plan will increase deficits by, you know, 5.5%, and the national debt's going to increase by 25% of GDP and so forth. So lots of concern, hawkery around the budgetary impact of the Trump plan. How are you going to pay for it? How are you going to pay for it? Going to cut taxes? Most of the time people say, we got to find the revenue, got to find money somewhere. You want to pay for infrastructure, you got to raise taxes. Not Donald Trump. So no, we're going to cut taxes to pay for it, because the tax cuts are going to lead to a more prosperous economy, and with growth comes higher tax revenue. And this is a very traditional kind of Reagan-like supply side trickle-down sounding sort of argument, but if you build it, they will come, is sort of embedded in this, right? Forget about the impact on the deficit. We're focusing on repairing, rebuilding America's infrastructure, right? We're going to provide tax relief. Right? And so this question doesn't seem to preoccupy Mr. Trump the way it does so many more conventional D.C. insiders. So what's behind the question, how are you going to pay for it? What's behind that thinking? First, the idea that the government is like the rest of us, that it has to find the money somewhere, that it's constrained in the same way a household is. It's got to earn an income, and if it doesn't have enough money to pay for everything that it wants to buy, then it's got to borrow the rest. And that when you borrow the rest, you got to find somebody who has money, who can lend you money. And the people who have money are going to charge you interest. And, you know, there's only so much money available to be loaned out, and if the government wants to borrow more of that limited pool of money, it means that there's less for everybody else. And so you get crowding out. Government spending crowds out other types of spending because there's no money now for private industry to borrow a portion, right? Some of that is crowded out. The idea that there's a fine line between a solvent government and an insolvent government. And it was right here at Harvard, after all, that we had the very impactful economic research coming out of Reinhart and Rogoff. The idea that there were tipping points, and that governments that allow their debt to GDP ratios to rise in the developed country world in excess of 90% run the risk of all kinds of bad negative things happening, including slowing economic growth and a higher risk of a financial crisis, debt crises, and so forth. So the idea that just like when we take on too much debt, we can go bankrupt, a private business can go bankrupt, a municipality can go bankrupt, look at Detroit, look at Puerto Rico. We know bankruptcy can happen for all of those individuals and entities, so why not the federal government? There must be a fine line between a government that's solvent and one that isn't. The idea that creditors can punish you when your debt gets too high, Fitch and Moody's, Standard & Poor's start looking at you and they say, hang on, you've got a lot of debt, and I don't think that you're a good credit risk anymore. You're no longer AAA. You're no longer AA. We're going to downgrade. And as you get downgraded, what happens? It becomes more expensive to borrow. It's like having your credit score go down. Well, now it's harder for you to get somebody to give you a credit card. When they do, you're going to have to pay higher interest or another type of loan. Right? So we see this happening in the world around us, and we presume the same rules apply for the federal government. Now you've been downgraded, your borrowing costs spike, and the next thing you know, you're Greece. Okay? That's the conventional thinking. These are, I call them zombie ideas. Why do I call them zombie ideas? Because like zombies, they're very, very hard to kill. How many of you have killed a zombie? No one. Because they don't die. They literally, well entrenched and hard to kill off kind of ideas. Most people do not even try to kill them off. Instead, they just repeat the standard Washington talking points that you heard in that first video clip. Mark Twain said, sometimes it's easier to fool people than to convince them they have been fooled. That seems to be the belief in Washington. Why buck the trend? Everybody thinks the debt is a problem. Everybody believes the deficit is a problem. I'm not going to be the guy or gal who gets up in front of my constituents and says anything otherwise. It would be political suicide. Except there's a new sheriff in town.
That's what I'm talking about. Mm. So now, a lot of the papers said, Donald Trump wants to go and start negotiating with creditors. First of all, you don't have to think about this, but we print the money. I mean, these people are crazy. This is the United States government. First of all, you never have to default because you print the money. I hate to tell you, okay? So there's never a default.
Okay. Now, that sounded crazy to a lot of people. First of all, I hate to tell you print the money, okay? So there's never going to be a default. First of all, these people are crazy. This is the United States of America, okay? We print the money. I hate to tell you, there's never going to be a default. And people went crazy. And the Wall Street Journal wrote articles saying, right, this man cannot be trusted. Forget the nuclear codes. Like, he can't be anywhere near the Oval Office. Because that is crazy speak. Except it wasn't crazy when Alan Greenspan said it. And it wasn't crazy when Warren Buffett said it. And it wasn't crazy when the St. Louis Fed put it in their reports. The exact words, in the exact language, with the exact framing, coming out of Buffett's mouth, Greenspan's mouth, and so on. Nobody called them crazy. All he's doing is saying what everybody else has readily admitted, okay? Which is that the United States of America has a sovereign currency. That we, as the federal government in the United States, is the monopoly issuer of the dollar. That the currency itself is a simple public monopoly. That the dollar comes from the US government and can't come from anywhere else. And if you think about what that means, the implications of that are that you quite literally can never run out of US dollars, that you cannot be forced by markets into defaulting on obligations in your own money, because after all, the US dollar can only come from the US government. You and I try to create it, it's called counterfeiting, right? And it's against the law. No one else, the US government has given unto itself the exclusive right to create the US dollar. And the implications are broad and significant as a result. Greece gave up the drachma. All of a sudden, Greece is borrowing in euros. But guess what? They don't create the euro, which gives rise to the problem that Greece faced when it came to making good on obligations in the euro. Right? They could only make payments if they could find the euro somewhere. And that meant either raising euros through tax revenue or finding someone willing to lend euros to the Greek government. It's a fundamental game changer. And we are not going to end up like Greece for the very reasons that Buffett and others explained. So really quickly, because I'm eating too much time, this is the debate we should be having. Okay, so I want you to listen to the question that Paul Ryan asks Chairman Greenspan, who is under oath at the time. And then we'll talk very quickly about the answer that Greenspan gives, and that I think this sets us up for the debate that we as a nation should be having right now.
So having personal retirement accounts is another way of making a future retiree benefits more secure for their retirement. And also, do you believe that personal retirement accounts as a component to a system of solvency does help improve solvency? Because when you have a personal retirement account policy, it's accompanied with a benefit offset. With that feature in place, do you believe that personal retirement accounts
can help us achieve solvency for the system and make those future retiree benefits more secure?
Well, I wouldn't say that the pay-as-you-go benefits are insecure in the sense that there's nothing to prevent the federal government from creating as much money as it wants and paying it to somebody. The question is, how do you set up a system which assures that the real assets are created, which those benefits are employed to purchase? So it's not a question of security, it's a question of the structure of a financial system which assures that the real resources are created for retirement, as distinct from the cash. The cash itself is nice to have, but it's got to be in the context of the real resources being created at the time those benefits are paid, so that you can purchase real resources with the benefits, which of course are cash.
So a few things, I love this group. A few things. First, that is not the answer Paul Ryan is going. Let's get that straight. That question was teed up so beautifully. There's a single sentence with the words personal retirement accounts four times used. It was like, I cannot make it more clear to you what I'm hoping you will say. Just say, yes, we should do this, right? And instead, Greenspan under oath says, I wouldn't say there's anything insecure about the way the system is set up today, in that there's nothing to prevent the federal government from creating as much money as it wants and paying it to someone. Quote. Quote. Okay? How many people have told you, future retirees, that your Social Security benefits are secure? Nobody. I'm guessing everyone has told you that your benefits are in jeopardy, that the system is going broke, and that it's probably not going to be around for you. And if it is, it's going to be a whole lot less generous, and it's probably going to be private and not public guarantees. Insurance, private insurance rather than public guarantee, right? I mean, that's what you've been told. Here's Alan Greenspan saying, there's nothing to prevent the federal government from making good on every promise to every future retiree, their dependents, and the disabled, on time, in full, in perpetuity. There's nothing to prevent us from doing that. Boom. So the affordability question is off the table. He's removed it. We don't have to talk about whether we can afford it. But then he goes on to make the really critically important point, and this is the debate we should be having. What does he say next? He said the question is, how do you set up a system which ensures that the real assets will be created, which those benefits are employed to purchase? You might notice I've seen this video a few times. I quote the whole thing. How do you set up a system that ensures the real assets will be there? What does he mean? He means we have changing demographics in this country and in so many countries around the world. Demographics are changing, and they've been changing for a long period of time. There are going to be fewer people working and producing stuff in the future. Baby boomers are moving out of the workforce and into retirement. So they're not going to stop consuming, right? So there are going to be fewer people working and producing stuff. And the question Greenspan is asking is, how do you make sure that when you send those benefit payments out on time, in full, in the future, that we are a productive enough economy, a productive enough society, that there's enough stuff for everybody to take some of it without what? Causing inflation. If there's not enough stuff because we aren't productive enough and we can't produce enough, then we're going to have people intensely competing for a smaller and smaller pool of real resources. And that's going to set off all kinds of antagonisms, not just economic ones, but social ones as well. And so the question is, what are the kinds of investments that we could be making today to make sure that 10 years, 20 years, 30 years from now, the U.S. economy is as productive as it can possibly be, right? Should we be investing in infrastructure, in education, in research and development? What is the key to raising future productivity growth? That's the debate. That's the fight. And they should be having a fight. No problem having politicians take different viewpoints and argue and fight. Great. But fight over the right kind of stuff. We shouldn't be fighting about where we're going to find the money. That's the wrong question. That's the wrong fight to have. Who's got the better policy idea for ensuring future growth of a prosperous economy so that there's enough stuff that we can take care of everybody without creating an inflation problem? Because inflation is the constraint. So that's Greenspan's point. You know, if we don't have an egg a nest with lots of eggs, then we're all going to be fighting over the same one, and it's going to create an inflation problem. So just, a couple hours ago, I saw this tweet. I threw this in here. Infrastructure. Donald Trump is talking about spending a lot of money on infrastructure. People are looking at the jobs numbers that came out this morning and saying, what makes you think that you can spend $1 trillion on infrastructure and have to hire a lot of people in the construction industry? And unemployment rates in the construction industry are only 5.7%. Now, it's an interesting question, right? Because it focuses our attention on the workers, the raw materials, the resources. Do we actually have enough stuff available that's not being already used that we could call forth and employ building infrastructure without causing inflation, without causing bottlenecks? Or do we have to bid those resources away from other users to get workers, to get raw materials and so forth? And then we're trying to do too much with too few resources and we have an inflation problem. But the question isn't about how you're going to pay for it, where you're going to find the money. The question is, do we have the real resources to make the investments to boost future growth and productivity and so forth? So that's the St. Louis Fed. Anyway, that's the point. I'm going to stop right there because I already did too much. So, sorry.
So I'm going to talk really briefly. I have only like four slides because I want a couple of misconceptions to be cleared up. And I think Stephanie alluded to a lot of those, but as many of you think about it, you know, this, I think hopefully this will be helpful. Because every time we have a debate about fiscal spending, it always comes out to, we have, you know, $19 trillion of debt, how do we pay for it? And Stephanie actually, you know, addressed that really well. But I want to show you the mechanics of that really quickly. Because the moment you start saying $19 trillion, the moment you start quoting deficits, you've already lost the debate, right? You've already constrained yourself by rules that have been designed for your personal household or corporation, but are not the type of rules that a sovereign government uses for its balance sheet. So I have here a 20, because I almost never carry cash, so it's shocking. It works better with a $1 bill. But like, what is this, right? Like, I mean, what is this thing we have in our hand, I have in my hand? Look, this is zero coupon perpetual debt. That's what this is. This is a liability of the United States government. And it's a liability as stated in the Federal Reserve Act of 1913, but it doesn't exchange for anything except for other pieces of paper, right? But it is zero coupon perpetual debt. What are the Treasury securities market, the market I worked in for a long time and still continue to work in? That is what we call finite debt, okay? That is debt with a maturity, with an interest rate. And what you see up here is something that you can find just doing 3 minutes of a Google search, right? This is the Federal Reserve's balance sheet. And I always find that interesting about people calling to audit the Fed and so on when they publish their balance sheets really in detail. It's available and there's a ton of information. So look on the asset side. What is that, you know, $2.4 trillion asset line? Those are US Treasuries, because they say so. What's on the liability side? Federal Reserve notes in circulation, about $1.35 trillion. Well, what are Federal Reserve notes in circulation? It's this. It's this stuff, right? It's this balance sheet that converts finite maturing debt into perpetual debt. And the back and forth movement of that is the job of this central bank. So this concept that we can't afford debt is like saying we can't afford this. And it's kind of a ludicrous concept, right? So the moment you start saying things like $19 trillion or we have all of this debt maturing or interest costs, you've already kind of fenced yourself in the debate about fiscal policy. Because this is what a combined federal balance sheet really looks like, right? At the bottom, you have the Treasury, and the Treasury's assets are the people's assets, right? It is national parks and federal land and taxable income and loan programs we make. And the liabilities are Treasury securities. But look, what's the Federal Reserve's assets? It's Treasury securities. And what's its liabilities? These notes and the reserves that banks keep at the Fed. So that diagonal relationship is never well understood or particularly well discussed, or maybe it's well understood but just not discussed, right? Because it comes off as sort of strange. And here's a real life example of what happens to some of the situations Stephanie described. When you have extraordinary debt to GDP, when you talk about Reinhardt and Rogoff, and you talk about downgrade of a credit rating agency. And by the way, the credit rating agency thing is a little bit personal, because I joined Treasury in May of 2011, supposed to be a quiet year of learning, and 3 months later we were downgraded by Standard & Poor's. And that was actually a really challenging time for staff, because it meant a lot of late nights, it meant a lot of work, and it meant trying to understand what the implications would be. Well, we have a real life example, right? So on the right hand side, you'll see the debt to GDP of Japan. On the left-hand side, you'll see the 10-year JGB rate, which is like the benchmark security rate of the government of Japan. So that debt moves up. Those arrows are showing downgrades by the credit rating agencies. And what happens to the yield of the 10-year JGB? Just a long slide down, right? And what this is saying is that the analysis you use for corporations or people who cannot create their own currency is not applicable to the analysis of a developed country sovereign market. And empirically, you can build whatever model you want, but here's a real-life example. And it's a massive example going on right now. The Bank of Japan has engaged in a massive quantitative easing program. And the real debate that's happening at the BOJ in Tokyo is, are there enough bonds to buy? Not, is there too much debt? And they actually have a hard time sourcing those bonds. And I say this because the Japanese were one of the first to kind of experiment with this kind of combined balance sheet. And not now. They actually did it in the 1930s, right? Sadly, their finance minister was killed by the military, but that was for completely different reasons. All right. So, and then of course, this is us. This is showing what the 10-year Treasury's performance was, and that's that horrible summer of 2011. Where we had one of our first debt ceiling crises. So 2 years later, we have one that's almost more awful. We were downgraded by Standard & Poor's. And of course, if the credit rating of debt goes down, I mean, what happens if your FICO score goes down? Your interest rates should rise. Not so. A massive rally in the yields of 10-year treasuries, right? The market actually understood, to some degree, a lot more than what policymakers seem to articulate, which is that this is not, this idea of solvency is not the right way to look at a developed country balance sheet. So I only have 4 slides, but I want that rules of the game to be well understood, because it is often not, right? For years, you've had people say, look at Japan, they are going to go bankrupt. And markets have tried to actually implement that view. They've tried to short Japanese government debt. They tried to buy credit default swaps on the Japanese government's liabilities. That trade is known as the widowmaker trade, because no one has ever made money, and in fact, they got wiped out trying to do it. Because the interest rate and risk premiums that are set by those rates are determined and can be determined by a central bank if it chooses to do so. So, I guess with that, I don't think I have anything else. So, I want, you know, to kind of open it up, I guess, right? So questions.
So I wanted to know, so even according to, right, so the government is not a household, right, and can take on more debt, and we should be building up, you know, fiscal stimulus and building up assets. But at what point is, I'm sure there's a line somewhere, right? I'm sure there's a line. And we know that even governments that have printed their own money and all that, at some point, there have been defaults. And so, where? No.
Yeah, I mean that's a choice, right? If you could create your own currency, you choose to default.
Right.
So in 1997 or 1998, when the Russian government defaulted on its local currency bonds, not its dollar debt, and that's a separate issue, but its ruble debt, that was a policy choice. That was not something they were forced into. They decided to do that
to avoid inflation.
It's on. What they got was a financial crisis, right? Which, you know, you could,
You can deal with inflation in a number of ways. In solving your banking system is something different.
So it's different for fixed exchange rate systems, yep. Which is what you're saying.
Yep. So is there no line at all?
No, there's a line, and what I tried to do was say that the constraint, the relevant constraint, is not a financial one. It is on the real side. It's real resources. So when I worked on the Senate Budget Committee, the chairman of the Budget Committee is Senator Mike Enzi from Wyoming. And Senator Enzi would commonly come into a hearing in the Budget Committee that he would call, because the majority calls hearings, and they were almost always about the debt crisis. And so he'd come in, and he would talk about the problem with our budget deficits. And he'd say, a deficit is evidence of overspending. Deficit is evidence of overspending. And I would say, not to him, because they didn't let me engage in that way, but I would sit there and fester, right? To myself, I'm saying, of course, that's not right. Evidence of overspending is inflation. Deficit is not evidence of overspending. Deficit is evidence of the fact that you've made a net contribution to the rest of the economy. So if you spend 100 into the economy and you only tax 90 out, you run a deficit, but someone got 10. Right? So there is a counterpart. There is my budget deficit is the surplus that resides elsewhere in the economy. And so evidence of overspending is inflation. A deficit is just evidence of a net contribution, a surplus that has been created in some other part of the economy.
And to that point, when you look at where Treasury rates are, and that those rates are composed of two things, what we call real rates and then sort of the inflation premium or the inflation expectation. When those rates are really low, there's a really good chance it's because expectations for inflation are really, really low. And that's telling you that demand itself is tepid. There is one place demand can come from, and it happens to be the federal government.
When we talk about the infrastructure, so Senator Sanders had a piece of legislation and has reintroduced it, so it's out again. $1 trillion of infrastructure over 5 years. Donald Trump's proposal is $1 trillion over 10 years, okay? Which one is the, let's suppose that they had the same funding mechanism, so-called. Which one would be the right one? Shouldn't we ask what is the real resource capacity of the US? Can we afford in real terms to do the same amount of infrastructure investment in half the time? I don't know, because I haven't looked at how much capacity there is in steel and the ability to move concrete and hire workers. But that's the right question, right? To ask what is the right time frame? What are the real resources? And can we do it without setting off an inflation problem?
Presumably, if we spend $1 trillion on things that actually increase the national wealth, as opposed to buying gold or something unproductive, then you have $1 trillion in liabilities, $1 trillion of useful assets. It's a good trade. But the constraint of inflation is real. Most people in this room expect to be alive in 49 years. And 49 years ago, I was a freshman at the college, and tuition was $1,800 a year. So we can always pay the bill, but if a Social Security check of $2,300 a month would have looked really good 50 years ago and may not look so good in 50 years.
I think that's a great point. And the idea that all deficits are created equal is certainly not the case. I mean, the type of spending that you do surely matters. And so you look for investment opportunities. When we talked about, Alan Greenspan's point, how are we going to ensure that there are enough real assets created? Well, who's got the plan to spend on the kinds of things that will increase future productivity and so forth? So, without any question.
Yeah. Okay, so I have a question about what you're saying and kind of drawing it to its logical conclusion, or theoretical conclusion, which would be if you were to have, let's say, a basic income scenario where you sort of control for the idea of you know that there's going to be a certain amount of production based on what the real productive capacity of the economy, but if that becomes much more productive than the demand for labor, then could a basic income scheme essentially fill in the gap in the idea of supplying that demand, or
okay,
creating that demand?
Let me address the question is about a basic income scheme. And my first instinct is to say we want to raise productivity. The point is to raise future output so that we can make these payments and investments and so forth in the economy to increase future productivity. I think that's best accomplished not by sending people money to consume the amount of stuff we're currently producing, but to raise the amount of stuff that we're producing, and that means employing more people. And so until I see a world where we've fixed all the problems and there's nothing left that needs to be done to employ people, right, to serve public purpose and so forth, then I'm reluctant to say the solution to the problem is to send out a universal basic income check. Look, Larry Summers has reintroduced this phrase, secular stagnation. And one of the things that Larry has done that's really, really critically important, I think, is to point out that, you know, we say that the U.S. economy is basically back to full employment, right? And we say, am I right? This is beautiful. We don't have chalkboards at my university. Everything's gone to whiteboard. I hate whiteboards. This is fantastic. So potential GDP, go back to 2007. And look at what people were forecasting. They said this is the trajectory out to 2020 or whatever for real GDP in the U.S. This is potential GDP. And our real GDP, our actual, was right here. I mean, we were essentially very close to full employment. And then the Great Recession happened. And what happened? Real output turned down. And as it did, forecasts of potential GDP were revised downward. And then the economy continued to sour because 2007, 2008, we're still in recession, and real GDP was revised downward again. And then eventually we got this like anemic sort of recovery thing going, but the revisions continued downward. And so what Larry points out is that by 2014, we were still, in actual real GDP, we were still 50% below what people thought our potential was going to be back before the crisis. In other words, it looked like we were closing in on full employment because actual GDP and potential GDP were getting closer and closer together. But Larry's point was, they're getting closer and closer together, not because we're raising the floor, but because we're lowering the ceiling. And if this is the case, and this is what he's describing as secular stagnation, then, and history, he uses this term hysteresis, which economists kind of throw around. But the question is hysteresis reversible? Can we raise our potential GDP back up again so that we have all of this additional future growth? And I think we can. I think that's a policy opportunity. But if we're content just saying this is the best we can do and we're at full employment, then we stay here and we say, well, we're at full employment, so let's just send people checks to consume things. I think we have to strive to reverse the damage that was done.
So
and that there's much more
potential. I'm sorry, just to make sure I understand you correctly. So what you're saying is that a concern about things like the effect of automation or the effect of labor market is premature, that we should wait until we can get the GDP back up through practical employment.
You know what I think we need? I think we need a universal basic job guarantee. More than we need a universal basic income. And the job guarantee goes directly to the people and the communities who are currently unemployed. And it does what we did in the New Deal era. It creates direct employment for people who need employment. And quite frankly, if you ask them, would you rather have a job and have something to contribute and a place to go and something meaningful to do all day, or would you prefer that we just send you a check? Overwhelmingly, people will say, I want a job. I want the connection to the community. I want to feel useful. I want to make a contribution. And it avoids the problem I'm concerned with the basic income is, so you send everybody a check for $20,000. Because it's universal, everybody gets the check. So the very wealthy buy Apple, more shares of Apple, and the poor just buy apples, right? And they eat them, and they've got nothing. And wealth inequality, which is already at levels that we saw last in the 1920s or so, just explodes as a result. I think the basic income is very dangerous in terms of the impact on inequality.
Yeah, Pete, you. So it seems like a lot of politicians would have an incentive to get excited about this and put y'all's theory on the forefront. People, there are people that want to go have more wars. There are people that want to cut taxes. There are people that want to build infrastructure. Who's fighting against you? Who's suppressing this idea from exploding outward?
I don't know how to answer that because I don't feel like anyone's fighting against it. I just feel like it's having trouble.
Why isn't Greg Mankiw teaching this, like, right now?
Well, partly I think this is, I mean,
go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say partly what I showed you was boring accounting. Right? Like, you're not going to win any prizes for what I showed you with a Google search on a $20 bill. Like, you know, there are some interesting pieces that float out there. If you really want to understand how a sovereign government's balance sheet works, like I recommend you read an old colleague of mine's paper, Seth Carpenter. You know, he used to be at the Fed. It's a primer on the Federal Reserve balance sheet. But, you know, the fact is that you can't get this in a soundbite. It's very hard to explain this. And chances are, if you're explaining this, you're probably already losing a political debate.
I think it's easy to explain. I spend most of my life on the road doing just that, and I think it's been extraordinarily successful. Why aren't people teaching it in the classroom? I'll make a confession to you. Faculty members hate to rewrite their lectures. And people who've been teaching for a lot of years don't even have to grab the lecture notes when they walk into the classroom anymore. They just know it, and it just goes. And it's hard, you know, it takes a lot of time to rewrite a lecture. And once you've committed yourself in writing, published, and so forth, and created for yourself, you know, a written transcript of past arguments, it's very hard to convince people to change a position. I mean, I think there are a lot of different reasons, but you're right. Nobody ever says, when it comes to war, how are we going to pay for it? Okay, the war spending, it is understood that the financing comes from the authorization. Congress authorizes the spending, and it triggers the release of the funds. Nobody knows or cares where the money is going to come from. It is the authorization to spend that, at the end of the day, is responsible for financing the spending. Everything that happens after that takes place between Treasury and Fed coordination to ensure that the payment system works as it's supposed to, that checks don't bounce when the Treasury makes the payment, and so forth. That all happens behind the scenes. Congress doesn't need to know or care, and they know it. All they have to do is say, we're going to spend to go war, and it happens. And they understand that when it comes to things like financing war, but somehow, when it comes to infrastructure, everybody thinks they have to, you know, dig up a shiny piece of metal to pay for something. It's like we're suddenly all on a gold standard.
And to add to that, we also probably have a lot more real-life examples now in the last, like, 15 or 20 years. And like I said, I think the events that are happening in Tokyo are extraordinarily important for a real-world understanding of how debt and money can, you know, work together or are effectively two sides of the same coin. We didn't have that many dramatic examples of that prior to this. So, I mean, I think it's helpful when reality starts actually shaping up. Yeah,
I guess this is related to Pete's question, but it seems like no one loses on this proposal. And in fact, even those currently in power, currently wealthy, would stand to gain with more widespread adoption of these kind of fiscal policies. So, given that reality, I guess what is the gap just an understanding gap in your perspective? Because if they would be better off along with everybody else, there'd be all the reasons in the world to explain boring things on a mass scale so that they can have more cash in their pockets.
Absolutely correct. And so what is the reluctance on the part of policymakers then to put forward, let's say, an infrastructure bill that's clean, that doesn't include a pay for? Because Senator Sanders' bill, for example, included a pay for. The pay for was closing tax loopholes. And so you say, I'm going to spend $1 trillion, and here's where I'm going to get the money. We're going to close a bunch of offshore corporate tax loopholes and other things, and that's going to pay for it. Which guaranteed, right then and there, they would not pick up any support from any Republican, because they would have to vote for a tax increase. So the question then is, what if you propose a piece of clean legislation? Just go to your colleagues and say, you guys need infrastructure in your state. We need it. We all agree. This is not typical wasteful government spending. We do infrastructure investment, right? could you get the votes? Could you get some Republicans to come on board? And then there the risk, I guess, is that it gets used against you in a future primary by someone who, you know, says, my opponent voted for HR, which boosted the national debt by, you know, so it's a political game. It's the end of the day, it's political.
And that's why, it's hard to come up with, like, really succinct talking points about this. And this is something we were talking about, you know, before we got here. Like, how do you package this in a way that, you know, proponents of infrastructure spending, of government spending, actually can utilize this in political
without
arena,
the fear of
without
repercussions. She's been trying for a really long time.
So your presentation was amazing. I have to keep pitching myself that you are socialist and not libertarian to make sure it's real. And I was a little bit, so if you already discussed it, you can skip it. But when you're talking about increasing the production so we can pay everybody, blah, 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 wouldn't be it much wiser then to tax consumption and not tax production at all? Because it would encourage even the poorest part of the population to get a second job. There was not taxed on it. They could keep all the money and so forth and so on.
What's the purpose of the tax?
So if every time you tax, you discourage behavior, and every time you don't tax, you encourage behavior.
So one thing that taxes do is impact potentially incentives, change behavior. Okay, that's one way to think about using the tax system to try to get people to conform, right, their behavior in different ways. Is the purpose of the tax to help the government get money?
Right.
Well, that was the point of our 15 minutes was to say the government, the federal government in the United States is the monopoly issuer, right? It can swim in little green pieces of paper once and can have all it wants. The point of the tax is to move real resources from private to public domain. And the way that you do that is you have tax liabilities that fall on a sufficiently large number of people in the population where they need the dollars. And they've got to go around working and producing things for the state in order to get the dollars that they need to settle obligations to the state. So we've got it backwards. If we think that the federal government needs dollars and they have to get them from us, we got this thing backwards. We need their dollars and we have to get them from them because they're the only place they can come from, okay? So let's get that piece right. It's not about getting revenue. So if the question is about a consumption tax, my question to you is, what is the goal? What is the goal? Or is it to discourage people from, because if the goal is full employment.
I'm talking about diminishing taxation of the production, not necessarily.
Okay, so you don't need to raise taxes to offset. You could cut taxes on production. So if you're
eliminate taxes on production.
Eliminate taxes on production. Okay. So these are all kinds of debates that could be had, I would say, if people wanted to debate the merits of taxing at the point of production versus at the point of consumption. Not about revenue.
And go ahead. It's interesting because there's all these different little taxes, like, you know, in the sort of the federal sort of scheme of things. And you think those taxes go toward that specific purpose. It doesn't. What happens is money all comes in, it all gets spent as part of the budgetary process and the outlays. And then, for example, with like Social Security, what happens is your Social Security taxes come in, it gets spent that year, and what happens is the Treasury writes an IOU and puts it inside the Social Security fund, and it's just an intergovernmental obligation. So it's not like this specific tax was going to go pay out to someone their Social Security benefits or needs. It's just another revenue stream that gets swept up into the government. So Stephanie's point about how much money the government needs versus what you're trying to do, is it changing behavior or is it doing something else? You can use that as an illustrative point. Right? Like, the money's all sort of fungible. It's not.
Yeah, but I would say even a little bit different because for me, I don't think of the government as spending the tax revenue, right? It's reclaiming some of what it already spent. So if the government runs a budget deficit, like I said, it puts 100 into the economy, It collects 90 out in taxes. Okay, it has reclaimed a portion of that which it already put in. So I put in 100, I take out 90, I've run a budget deficit. The 90 didn't pay for anything. Yeah. It's just me taking back 90 of my own previously issued IOUs. I've reclaimed them. What do I need them for? I can rip them up, I can shred them, I can, you know, light them on fire. It doesn't matter. I just, when I want to spend again, I put new ones in. And then through tax collection over time, quarterly tax payments, corporate tax payments, personal income, tax revenue flows in. And his point is that tax revenue is flowing in, and nobody's saying this dollar came from the highway trust fund, this one goes into, this one came from, right? It doesn't work like that. It just all comes in, and then entries are made in different accounts to account for some portion of what was reclaimed.
So I'm wondering, how does this apply differently, or if it does at all, to local and state taxes? Because if I'm paying, say, money to the city of Cambridge, that money is then being spent by the city of Cambridge, and they can't print their, there's no Cambridge currency, right?
Yep.
So
I think you just answered your own question. What's the difference between the federal government and a municipal government or a state government? And the answer is, municipal governments, state governments are users of the dollar, just like you and I are, just like private businesses, whereas federal government, the issuer of the currency. And that is a fundamental difference. So for a municipality, tax receipts are genuine revenue. And they go into an account, and they are constrained by their ability to raise revenue or borrow, right?
So the debt there is real.
It's
similar to corporate.
There is a constraint that is very different.
There's real credit risk with a state and local government. They cannot just create their own. So in fact, you can almost compare Europe is much more, the countries that are part of the EMU are much more similar to state and local governments in the now, because they are in the same way unable to create like their own currencies.
I see over there, I'm gonna try to get everybody else first. In the back.
Your argument about the US dollar as a global reserve, that's well taken. But my question is that, then why is it that we have the debt ceiling within our statutes? Is that something that the economists
The debt ceiling has nothing to do with reserve currency status.
And that's not what makes the dollar special.
And that's not what makes the dollar special, right? But just to address the debt ceiling point, it's a very strange kind of legislative thing that we have. In most places, that's just an output. It's not something you have to keep raising. The debt ceiling is something that was created a long time ago when the federal government became a regular and predictable issuer of Treasury securities. And you know, Congress basically wanted to say, we want to have this much, and then we want to have this much, right? But the reserve currency status of the United States is not you know, dictated by the debt ceiling. It would be jeopardized, I believe, if we did not actually raise the debt ceiling and we defaulted on our securities markets. That's, you know, you can harm yourself with the debt ceiling. It does not help you, though.
When I gave the example of running a deficit, putting 100 in and taking 90 out, you've left 10 behind, mm-hmm. right? Under current law, and this is self-imposed, this is Congress saying, when you run budget deficits, you're required to borrow. So I put 100 billion in, I took 90 billion out, somebody's sitting there holding 10 billion in their checking account at the Federal Reserve, and now I'm required to borrow. So I hold up this Treasury bond, and it's 10 billion. And I say, who wants to buy this? Now, someone who's sitting there holding a non-interest-bearing checking account says, I'd rather have my money in a savings account. And so they bid on the Treasury bond. And so they end up getting a savings account instead of a checking account. So I take $10 back, $10 billion, and I give them a $10 billion treasury, which means the government bond has become a repository for savings. That's all it is. It is just another way in which to hold U.S. dollar savings. So when we talk about a debt ceiling, we don't want to raise the debt ceiling. What we're really saying is we don't want to raise the ceiling on private savings, non-government saving. It's a savings ceiling. And we're somehow reluctant to increase it. It makes no sense whatsoever.
Thanks for the talk. I'm just wondering, so you're basically talking about debt financing as an alternative to taxation, and that there are real issues underlying, you know, real spending and real activity happening underneath it. What would you say are the distributional effects? Obviously, you mentioned inflation. I know that right now you might say it's a free lunch because we're not seeing any inflation. But certainly, as you increase debt financing, as you increase the debt, the potential for future inflation, which you might have to head off with, you know, raising interest rates, maybe at a time where it's not ideal to do so, and causing another recession. What are the real distributional effects of more debt financing versus more explicit tax financing?
Okay, so a few things. One is what I was trying to do was to say that instead of trying to force the economy to balance the budget, which is what we typically see countries try to do, we should allow the budget to balance the broader economy, macro goals, full employment, low inflation, and so forth. So that if that's what you're doing, you're calibrating the size of the budget deficit to the status in the real economy, to the situation in the real economy, which itself is a form of constraint, okay? So what are the distribution effects, and at what point do you have an inflation problem with the debt that gets too big? So let's talk about that. So we run budget deficits, and because when we run budget deficits, we're requiring ourselves, under current law, to borrow, so to issue treasuries. So now we've got this interest payment that's being made in addition, right? It's an additional income payment. Bondholders receive interest, and it becomes income to them. So if they go out and they spend the income because of interest, right, then what happens? They're spending into the real economy, which then creates demand for goods and services, which then leads to job creation, which then reduces the size, the need for a larger budget deficit in the future. So that's stabilizing. Is it possible that the debt gets to a level where the interest income is so significant and bondholders are all saying, I want to spend my interest income, I'm not rolling it over into more government securities, all of a sudden I don't view this as saving anymore, this is now going to finance my consumption. And what are the consequences? One consequence could be, just like spending from anywhere else, that it leads to too much demand and you get inflationary pressures. That's certainly possible. Is the answer then for the Fed to raise interest rates to fight inflation? If you raise interest rates and you're rolling over debt and now you're paying higher interest and the interest income has been the problem, this is going to exacerbate the inflation problem, not solve it. And so I would suggest that that's the wrong policy response to
you
that kind of
just
problem.
Scale
the right,
back. Yeah.
The right policy response is to reduce other types of government spending or increase taxes. If it's demand pull inflation that's causing the problem, then you've got to do something to restrain demand. And it's not always clear that interest rates are the right tool.
You talked about the, I want to go back to the question about universal income. You talked about public sector debt, but what about private sector? Isn't there a crisis in private sector debt, which is consumer debt, student loan debt? And isn't there a segment of the economy of the population that is still highly leveraged and getting even more leverage? And isn't that deflationary? And shouldn't the government do something about that?
Well, I'm glad that you brought up private debt, because you're right. The focus here for us today was on public sector. Is there a crisis? You said, is there a crisis in private debt? There is, perhaps, in some kinds of debt. You mentioned student loan debt. There are people who believe that now at 1.3 and closing in on 1.4 trillion, and an awful lot of that in default or nearly in default, that this is evidence of a crisis in private sector debt in the form of student loan debt. I'm sympathetic to that argument. But look, compared to where we were, the household sector has substantially deleveraged. Balance sheets are in much better shape today than they were. And even if some types of debt have increased in absolute terms, in terms of debt to income ratios for most Americans, anyway, things look better than they did 8 years ago. So I'm probably not comfortable.
But the student loan one is an interesting point,
yeah.
Right?
Go ahead.
The federal government is the largest provider of student loans, and the real sad part about this, and I want to call it, is reform of the student loan program so that people aren't carrying around hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of private liabilities. It can be fairly straightforward. I mean, if you really, the federal government can do any number of things. But the framework which we think about federal debt really prohibits us from doing that. Why? Because when you look at the budget, anytime you make a change to a program like that, such a large program, it's a net present value benefit to the budget. Meaning, the federal government borrows at treasury rates, it lends out, you know, at student loan rates, and effectively it captures that spread. And it basically shrinks the deficit, right? And that's something that's really important to almost every single policymaker that that Stephanie has cited in her video. So if you make any changes to the program, all of a sudden this is no longer what they call budget neutral. It starts having an impact on the deficit. And people are really loath to do that. But if you listen to the presentation, this isn't a really big deal. If you think students have too much debt, you can fix this in a pretty straightforward manner and just recognize it's going to change your deficit, your deficit calculation. And if you're okay with that, great. But unfortunately, people aren't really okay with that. And that's kind of why, that's the crux of the matter of why, we haven't been able to get what I call substantial student loan relief. I mean, they're trying really good programs like income-based repayment and a whole number of other things. But in reality, you could just say, yeah, I think it's pretty high. I think we just have to change the ratio of that from grants to, loans versus grants. So, yes.
You've mentioned a number of ideas that I think sound maybe easier on paper than they are in practice. And as a former fixed income investor and bank analyst, the things that in my mind kind of maybe hold up the helicopter money policies that you've talked about, some of the growth initiatives that you'd like to see are maybe declining capital flows from global trade, bank deregulation in the US, and then this kind of potentially new tax policy that may increase inequality in a way that doesn't drive growth as we might like. Can you talk about your inflation outlook, kind of given these other factors? The potential for, say, inflation to pick up as M0 stays constant, but the private sector creates more credit, or as capital inflows into the US maybe slow down, deficit financing.
Can I try this? Sure, I've been in fixed income markets since I was 22 years old, and I'm much older than I think I look. but part of the reason I went to Treasury was because at the time they were staffing up with fixed income professionals because they knew the next several years were going to be hard. I don't think anyone really has a good handle on how to predict inflation. I look at market forwards, and that basically tells me as much information as I think anyone else has. A lot of these things you relate to in terms of bank deregulation, capital flows, I think it's very empirically questionable what impact they have on inflation. I think the world kind of conforms to that type of regulatory environment. And yeah, so I wouldn't trade on, is what I would say.
I was just going to add, and it ties back into his question from just a minute ago. He's not looking, but I'm going to touch on that one. Look, I would say, if I'm just speculating, if we get the kinds of policies that have been proposed so far, I think the inflation outlook is more robust now in the U.S. because we don't have this huge reliance on the Federal Reserve. So when he was asking about at what point, how much debt before you get an inflation problem, look at Japan. Japan is closing in on a quadrillion yen in outstanding public debt, 240-some% of GDP, okay? And still, it's deflationary pressures that have been the problem. The ECB with the QE, with deflationary pressures. It's not that easy to create inflation, is my first point. And it seems more and more, the evidence has accumulated to show us that it doesn't happen through central bank channels. And the reason is that all that QE is sucking all that interest income out of the economy. So every time the central bank buys mortgage-backed securities or government bonds, it's taking those assets and putting them on their balance sheet where they sit, accumulating all of the interest that otherwise would have been paid to the non-government sector. And so it acts like a tax. People think QE is a stimulus, but it has a very significant effect that works very much like a tax. So it's no puzzle for some of us to think about why it's been deflationary pressures rather than inflationary pressures that have resulted. If we're going to reach a point where we move away from doing the QE and doing more traditional, fiscal policy, tax cuts and increased spending, I think there is much more potential for wage increases and other price increases here, and that will be probably transmitted to other parts of the world as well. So.
And the last 2 weeks, markets have reacted to that. You can see bond markets pricing in higher inflation expectations for all the things Stephanie was talking about.
Yeah, just so when you on how the money is spent, just a question on that. So usually when we imagine it, we imagine like 1930s large infrastructure projects. You build a dam, you clear trails. Two alternatives that I'd love to hear your thoughts on. One is, do you think that there's a role for like public venture funds or venture grants to create more small businesses with that, and would that serve the use? And then two is, do you get that real productivity if it's the caring economy, if it's taking care of the sick, taking care of the old, taking care of the young, mentally ill, homeless, things like that, if it's not like creating real like steel, but it's what most of new jobs are in service?
So I'm sort of, in my frame, I'm back in my federal jobs program, because it's sort of...
Yeah, that's that. Yeah, it's about the federal jobs
WPA
program.
WPA-style,
yeah.
Building up infrastructure, national parks, the arts. Don't forget, the Works Progress Administration, the Civilian Conservation Corps, the National Youth Administration, this alphabet soup of programs that were part of the New Deal, did everything from building stadiums and hospitals and national parks to... putting on theater shows and having sculptures and public art and everything else. So there's a wide range of things. So does everything have to be so-called productive in the sense that we can calculate a return on investment in conventional ways? Absolutely not. Not in my mind. Anyway, if we've got people that we can employ in classrooms, in nursing care facilities, who can sit and hold the hand of someone who's, you know, in a nursing home facility or something, play a game of cards with them, read a book with them. Is that a worthwhile investment? To me, it is. But that's a policy question, and in a democratic society, we get to decide those sort of things. But there are certainly enough types of employment, enough things to do, some of which would meet traditional standards for, you know, high ROI type of stuff, and others that would not. I forgot the first part.
The first part was like, could it come in the form of public venture capital?
Sure,
for,
you could. I mean, when money is no object in the sense that you've taken off the table, how do we pay for it, sorts of questions, then you get to just get down to the nitty gritty, what should we be doing? What do the people broadly support? What do people want government involved in? How do they want government involved? And those are questions for democratic society, right? But could you decide that you want to see more small entrepreneur startup organizations, and it would make sense to put government funding behind some of that? And sure you could.
You previously referred to DOJ. Now, what would be the biggest risk to the DOJ right now? And if there is any, how would that affect the U.S.-Japan relations?
Well, I think the risks to the BOJ, so one of the things we're working on at where I work right now is trying to figure out why, you know, there's sort of been, both from the fiscal and monetary side, not great coordination and sort of the stopping and starting process that's gone on in the government of Japan. So for example, the BOJ would engage in extraordinary monetary policy, and then the government of Japan would raise like its consumption tax. You know, so on one hand, you're trying to be stimulative, and the other hand, you're kind of like taking away, right? So, you know, the risks is kind of like, one, is like fighting each other, like, you know, both sort of sides of the house not coordinating in an effective manner. But the other thing is you know, there's always just the failure of imagination in this. I was at an IMF conference maybe about a year ago with one of my colleagues, Van Lee, and you know, what was asked of the BOJ representative who was there was, I don't understand why you're worried about the fiscal side of the house right now with your debt to GDP. The Bank of Japan is buying the debt. If you really just optically wanted to reduce the government's debt burden, the Bank of Japan can literally cross out that debt that it owns. And there's a little accounting that goes on in there, and you have to make sure legally you can do it. But that accounting concept for central banks is called a deferred asset. Okay? And all it means is, quote, there's negative equity at the central bank, and now you have to fill in that accounting gap. It's a deferred asset. What does that mean? I mean, Like, it's not like a regular bank where, you know, oh, you're insolvent because, you know, you're equity. Like, it's a central bank, right? So, what's up?
Does that get written off from the balance sheet?
It can be, yeah. I mean, like, so, you know, you'd, as if I remember correctly, and don't hold me to this, you amortize the deferred asset over time. But, you know, this is fairly straightforward stuff. And again, like that paper I referenced, you know, the Carpenter paper, you know, briefly touches on that. Not all central banks can legally actually do that. But this is not a huge issue, because this question was originally asked when the Federal Reserve went through its own extraordinary actions and when it bought mortgages, for example. What happens if all of these mortgages go to zero? What happens if it burns right through the equity of the central bank? Well, in part, this primer was meant to answer, A, first of all, the Fed doesn't like actually mark to market its portfolio, so don't have to worry about that. So it has to be real impaired losses. And two, if this does happen, you know, how would the accounting work? And the accounting would just work in that there would be this deferred asset that would take place. So, so to me, like, understanding all of those movements kind of like tamps down people's fears of the combination of these balance sheets.
Now, so DOJ, similar to the Fed, also has a monopoly of printing out the yen, right? So does that also imply that they don't really have to worry about the fiscal side, very similar to my previous question about...
Yeah, and by the way, a lot of the DOJ documents are in Japanese, which I don't actually speak, so it's very possible that they are not the sole monopoly creator of it. Maybe there's... but I assume they are, yeah. But, yeah, so... You've answered the question. That's correct, right? That they should not have to worry about this fiscal issue. And the market is telling them not to worry about the fiscal issue in real life, and it has been for 30 plus years.
Hussein?
Yeah. So if policymakers start to adopt your perspective on this, is there a risk that we allocate real assets in ways that are unproductive? So let's say that, you know, you don't think that the best use of real assets is to build a giant wall between Mexico and the U.S. And if we say that the argument shouldn't be we can't afford this, then is there a risk that the things that are right now most popular and the things that are most profitable to the people who are most well connected to government and to policymakers are the things that will get done first, and therefore exacerbating inequality if you're worried about that, or just reducing productivity in the long term because real assets are tied up in unproductive ways?
I think that's already how it works.
That's right.
You know? I mean, it's people will sometimes say this, well, what if Washington ever figures this out? What if they? But I think they fundamentally know it. And I know that they know it when it comes to war. I know that they know it when it comes to war. And so that's a massive use of real assets that maybe most of the population would not say we want that at the top of the list, right? But these guys and gals, they get to vote and decide on policy that moves real resources around in the economy, and I don't think there's probably been a time when the majority of the population would have agreed with the rank ordering the movements there, but I don't think that the understanding changes anything. I think it just opens up space to allow us to do more. You know, the typical thing is in economics, it's the guns and butter. Have you seen the right? And you've got this idea that you have to make trade-offs, and that presumes that you're working in an economy that's already at full employment. And if you have an economy that's already at full employment and all the resources are used, then yes, it is true. If you want to divert resources, if you want to take resources and put them into more defense, then you have to take them away from non-defense. And so that's the idea with this guns and butter argument, right? You have to redeploy and shift resources around. But if you're actually at less than full employment and you have unused resources, then you can have more guns and more butter, or you can just have more butter, or you can just have more guns. But that's a question for the voters and ultimately through them, the policymakers.
And the productivity argument, like, so it doesn't have to be decided what you're spending the money on at the federal level. You can do it at state and local levels, right? One of the most successful programs that came out of the Recovery Act was the Build America Bond Program, where the federal government subsidized states who wanted and communities that wanted to borrow money for things that were like infrastructure projects. So they got to decide what was the right project for their citizens and users, and they were able to utilize, in some part, the federal balance sheet. So, you know, if you're concerned that it's going to be used in not a productive way, will you try to bring the decision down as close to the level of the people who are impacted
That's
by it?
That's such a good point. Yeah. And it works that way with what I was talking about earlier with the employment guarantee. If the funding has to come from the federal level, but the programs can be administered at the state or local. The more local, the better, right?
Yeah.
Because local communities best understand their needs and how to use resources and what's available and what the greatest needs are and so forth. So federally funded, locally administered, both with the federal job program and then these revenue distributions, these revenue, they used to call it revenue sharing back in the 70s. Republicans liked this. I think Nixon did revenue sharing. But yeah, you give the money to the state and then the channeling of those resources happens at the state level down through localities.
I'm going to purposely do an extreme case to help me see, because you're basically saying that there's no constraint on revenue, because after all, government prints the money. So let's say the next 2 years was a tax holiday. Why tax at all?
Mm.
What would happen?
Okay, so a number of things.
Tax at the federal level.
Federal level.
Yeah.
So that we do still have taxes in place. Okay, that's important. That's important. So we're not eliminating every form of tax, because if we did, the question would then become, then why would anyone work to get dollars? So we would run the risk of undermining the value of the currency. Okay, so we're going to still have taxes in place. So the question is, why not have a tax holiday where for a year or two you suspend all federal income taxes? You could do that. What would be the implications? Perhaps inflation, right? I mean, that would be the most significant implication. If I'm not paying any federal income taxes at all, my take-home pay, that's my disposable income that's available to me,
yeah,
significantly.
I'm not going to buy a Tesla at the same time.
I'm going to get one. That's a constraint on my not having one right now, is that I do pay federal income taxes, and that would put me a whole lot closer to getting one. So yeah, but everybody's going to buy more, you know, of a lot of things. So inflation is the relevant constraint there. I can't remember if you asked a second part
that's
of that
really,
question.
It doesn't, you made it, I'll say an extreme case is extreme enough that even though that Bernie Sanders didn't dare say it publicly, and you said if it's okay to spend $1 billion and not tax for it, I can see it if we spend it on highly productive stuff, but if we're going to include holding the hands of people in nursing homes, which is God's work maybe, but it doesn't produce the Social Security income that people are going to need in 40 years, in the way that a dam or a new dock facility.
It's about the kind of society we want to live in.
Right.
So instead of having the probably woman work part-time because she has to spend half of her time with her mother in a facility doing exactly those things, then it employs someone else. She feels good. She knows mom's got somebody to talk to.
Right.
She's not lonely. Somebody's there with her. Now she can take more hours at work. And so overall productivity in the economy goes up as a consequence of programs like this. So I do think that they can achieve multiple goals in that way. Look, we had a payroll tax cut, which does something like what you're talking about. It didn't say nobody paid federal income taxes for a year, but it said 150 million plus Americans who are working and paying into the Social Security system and have that withholding, that FICA withholding on your paycheck. Instead of withholding 6.2% of your take-home pay, we're only going to withhold 4.2%. So we had a 2% cut. And this was part of what was done when the economy was in the recovery phase, but the recovery was looking a little bit weak and shaky, and people said, oh my God, we don't want to double dip and have another recession. Let's have a payroll tax cut. Some of us, myself included, were arguing for something much more ambitious, a full payroll tax holiday. Go the full 6.2% on the worker and the employer. That's a 6.2% pay increase right off the bat, and all you have to do is reprogram the computer. You feel it immediately, and people's take-home pay goes up. And so families would have been looking, like the median income family, would have been looking at an extra, I can't remember exactly what we ran the numbers, let's say $350 or so a month in take-home pay for the average family. That's not small change. That's significant. And so that's a way of eliminating a tax temporarily. We call it a payroll tax holiday until the economy picks up significantly, unemployment is down low, and until inflation becomes a problem, then you reinstate all or some portion of that. But of course, people worry that, well, that puts Social Security in jeopardy. Well, no, it doesn't, because as he already explained, you just deposit the, make the record, and that's exactly what was done with the payroll tax cut. They just made good on the promise so that the trust funds were not, quote, compromised as a result. But yeah, you can have sweeping tax cuts of that kind. And what's the effect? The effect is people's income goes up. And then what? Well, depends on
inflation. If you're not increasing more goods simultaneously with the cut on your taxes, then the actual real distributional effect is inflation.
Yeah. So demand creates its own supply, and what producers do is they watch the line growing outside the door. You open up your shop, you open up your restaurant, the line's wrapped around the corner. That's a pretty good indication that you need to hire another busboy, you need to hire another, you know, a couple of people for your wait staff and another chef, and, you know, order more salad and fruit and flour and whatever, right? I mean, this is what triggers the investments that take place.
And that's kind of what was kind of missing for a large number of years, which is that CEOs or CFOs would see these lines forming and they're like, I want to invest in productive capacity for the economy. Instead, what a lot of the extraordinary measures did was drive up the price of financial assets rather being redeployed into real assets.
And then hoping for a wealth effect that triggers some consumption, that then triggers, you get the increase in demand, that triggers some additional investment spending and some hiring and so forth. But business is higher when they're swamped with customers. That's what it takes.
Anybody else?
Thank you all.
I actually just one thing. I think that most people in this room probably get this, but since we're being recorded and we'll be watching this in the future, you mentioned something sort of briefly during the talk, we sort of alluded to throughout the questions, you said that when we're talking about the national debt, part of the choice is how many treasury securities do we want our children to inherit? If you could just speak briefly about how we should think about the national debt in particular, just to sort of elucidate what that actually really means for the United States.
Can I say two things and then I want you to finish, because let's leave it on your insights. One thing that I found shockingly disturbing when I spent time on the Hill was we left a hearing, and I walked out with a member of the Senate, I won't say who, and I asked, if you had a magic wand, and you could just wave the magic wand, and the national debt would disappear, and all of your colleagues, all 100 of you, could do the same thing, take the wand, wave the wand, the national debt is gone. How many do you think would choose to wave the wand and wipe out the national debt? Everybody. Okay, everybody. Well, what if you had a magic wand and you could wave the wand and all U.S. treasuries would just disappear, would just evaporate and be gone? Puzzled look. I don't know how to answer the question. I said, but you already did. You already did, right? Because that's what the national debt is. It's nothing more than the sum total of all of the outstanding treasuries that exist in the world. That is the national debt. Now, this person was totally confident that we should eliminate the national debt, but not at all comfortable with the idea that there should be no treasuries anywhere in the world. That's a disconnect that is a huge problem. I mean, you're the fixed income guy, right? That's a problem, that you don't know that one implies the other. So what is the national debt? It's all the outstanding treasuries, and the people who hold them call them their assets. There are liabilities on the balance sheet of the treasury, as you showed, but to those of us who have them, they're assets. So when people start moralizing about the national debt, like in that video, burdening the next generation, you can't burden an entire generation. Okay, the future generations will be comprised of both taxpayers and bondholders. And at best, what we're talking about is a distributional question, where there are taxpayers and there are bondholders, and some people will be receiving interest on the treasuries, and some won't, because some won't hold them, right? But they are assets to those who hold them, whether in the present or in the future. So you cannot burden an entire generation. You're going to have future people who are taxpayers. And in the future, there will also be bondholders. And at the end of the day, the national debt is, like I said, just a repository for our savings, an interest-bearing, safe, default risk-free, with a nice kicker on the side, which is called interest, right, that you get for taking no risk. It's kind of a good deal.
Yeah, everything she said on that. And you know, just one last thing on that, which is that it would not be beneficial to the United States if the Treasury securities market disappeared. It is a vibrant market that is effectively the, you know, I would call it the grease that moves the wheels of our financial markets. You use it for an asset, you use it as collateral. It is effectively money, right? And that money is the way people, those securities are the way people hold US dollars, right? Like, so the State Administration for Foreign Exchange in Beijing does not sit on, you know, $2 trillion sitting. It sits on, you know, $2 trillion plus United States treasuries. It is their asset. You know, eliminating the debt effectively eliminates those securities. Eliminating those securities may actually, in a way, impair one of the good things about America, which is that we have deep and liquid capital markets that if you have an idea or a concept, you know, you should be able to find a pretty good actor to deliver you capital to put it to work. I'm not saying that's how it always works, but it works a lot better than it does in a lot of other contexts.
The name is so problematic, just calling it the debt, you know? Nobody wants to be in debt, here debt. That's just a pejorative. It's a word that we have a sort of visceral reaction to, and we're just averse to the idea of debt. So if we could start calling it a national savings account or something, rename the thing, I think it would go a long way to, you know, reducing domestic and global anxiety.
All right, any other questions? Okay, thank you all for coming.